Check, 1, 2, 3, check. Check. You got me? 1, 2, 3. Perfect. That's what it is.
You can all hear me back there, yeah, right?
Okay.
Hey guys, how you doing? Welcome once again to our next session of our, this is like, you ever see Bravo Network where they have the one-on-one and the guy, the dude that always, you know, interviews the very famous and popular people on Bravo?
Yes.
I'm better. Yes. The celebrity that we have here in attendance this weekend. It's really interesting that with my next guest here, that no one ever remembers the name. They don't remember the name, but the face is irreplaceable. There is no other face like this one, as handsome as it is, in the absolute entire world. But his contribution to the film industry is perfect, because no one ever forgets this gentleman. Let's put out a nice warm welcome to Mr. Michael Barrowman. How you been?
Excellent.
We were just talking, and I just, before I even knew that he was going to become a guest here at Space Coast Nerd Fest, I was watching an episode of Star Trek The Next Generation, and it's one of my favorite episodes, known as Conspiracy. You know, when Starfleet is being controlled by a little worm in the ear and whatever, but there was a contingency of people who recognized things were happening and wanted to bring Picard into the fold, yada, yada, yada. And he was the zipperhead alien, as I called, you had some really scary roles. It was really appropriate, too, that you did. Let's start off with that. Did they actively seek you out to portray that role for Star Trek The Next Generation?
Yes, they did. I did not audition. What happened was, I worked with Leonard Nimoy. He was my director in The Voyage Home. And I have a very good established reputation of being able to wear prosthetics. I don't perspire, so that helps a lot of anybody who's in the makeup. You understand what it means to keep an edge laid down. I actually have my ears from the graphics display officer. They deteriorate over time, but I have a couple totes of collectibles that if the house catches fire, they go out the window first, then the dog, then the cat, and hopefully my wife. We did that one. So after doing that, and working with Fred Phillips, the originator of Spock's ears back in the day, Fred Phillips and I worked together on One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, so that's when I had my first prosthetic. So jumping back and forward in time, they just called my agent and said, well, we'd like to have Michael come on board for Next Generation. And it was a good story, and they just said, come on down. I'm a big fan. I knew Majel, I'd known her for years, and we always had a lovely conversation at breakfast. You'd tell the stories how science fiction wasn't really what Paramount wanted until it became popular.
Mm-hmm. Well, talking of popularity, and I'll go, I want to segue backwards into your film career. Mm-hmm. And probably your most, my most famous, liked, and recognizable role was in the movie, like you've already mentioned, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. And you, in fact, stood out in that movie as well. But to be working with so many, you know, incredible legends, including yourself, during that movie, I'm sure you probably have a warehouse of stories, because with all of you knuckleheads in the same room together, I'm sure there were total amounts of shenanigans that went on during that filming process. Is there anything that you could legally tell us, and how much would you want if it wasn't legal for you to tell us?
Well, actually, I'm writing my autobiography. I'm at page 87. Sometime next year, I'll either self-publish or shop it around. I had worked one day before I did Cuckoo's Nest. I was tapped heartly, and I was discovered by a gentleman named George Powell, producer of War of the Worlds. I graduated from college with a degree in art history. I tried veterinary science, but with my birth defects, my hands, I couldn't really do justice to an animal that needed any kind of work. So I studied vet science, I studied art history, and I graduated in 1972 from Cal Poly San Luis Obispo, and I figured, what am I going to do? I have a degree in art, but you know, you don't really get hired for that, so what do I do? What do I do? So I was going to homestead in Alaska and study conservation, habitat preservation. I got involved with a wolf sanctuary for 20 years. In the mix of all of that, I never made it to Alaska. I was getting ready to go, but I had a diversion. It was called George Powell. I was in Venice Beach, and I had a little arty-farty gift shop, you know, kind of hippy-dippy. Everybody put their stuff up, you know, hoping you could pay the rent and hang out. And this George walks into my shop, and he goes, are you an actor? No, man, I'm not an actor. I love film, I love storytelling. He goes, uh-huh. He says, well, he literally did this with the hands. You have the look that I need to play the coroner in a Doc Savage movie. I go, what? The Doc Savage? I said, well, you know, I had those books. Those are pretty cool stories. And I go, well, why do you want me? He said, well, you look the role, and you can speak. I think you could, you know, do your lines, and we'll have fun. I go, well, who's playing Doc Savage? He goes, oh, Ron Ely. And I go, well, that's cool. And I go, well, who are you? And he goes, I'm George Powell. He hands me a card. And I go, do you know who you are? He tapped me on the shoulder and he goes, it'll be fine. Just call my office. So I worked for one day, gave me a 2-day guarantee. And if you study labor history, I was Taft-Hartleyed into the Screen Actors Guild Union. Day one is a freebie, day two, you have to join the union. So he paid my membership fees. I got paid $400 for 2 days' work. I had a union card. And then I went home and I go, oh, now what do I do? I had no clue. So I said, well, I'm going to go to Alaska, fill out the forms, build a log cabin, meet the girl of my dreams, appreciate nature and forest and all that good stuff. And I get a phone call. I go, hi, we're Mike Fenton and Gene Feinberg. We're casting directors. We cast a movie for George Powell. We're doing another little project. And George sent us a photograph of you. And we understand your father's a brain surgeon, so I think you'll be a good fit with your craniectomy that you had and the way that you look with your skull. And if we put some scars on your forehead, you could be a lobotomy patient for One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. And I blinked my eyes a few times and I said, you know, that's a lot to take in. Is this a prank call? And they said, no, come down to Culver Studios and meet Michael Douglas, Joel Douglas, Saul Vance, Wheelis Berman, and Jack Nicholson. And I go, well, let me see if my schedule's clear. Oh, it just happens to be there. What time do you need me? And I went, and I did. And I went to Salem, Oregon. I was there for 127 days, 6 days a week. My lobotomy scars were put together by Fred Phillips. It was mortician's wax with some makeup artist. Help me out. What do you put over the other side? It seals it. I forget what it is.
Spirit count.
Yeah, thank you. And it was fantastic. The day that Jack Nicholson had to come in for his lobotomy scars, Fred was, it was like, you know, after maybe day 60, 70, 80, down the line, and he had to shave a couple little hairs on his receding hairline, and Jack goes, Fred, they'll grow back, won't they? And I looked at Jack and I go, come on, really? Really? And it was a real hospital, Oregon State Hospital. Dr. Spivey was the real doctor at the facility. We spent 2 weeks of rehearsals with camera, major scenes, and we had to spend an hour a day, 6 days a week, for 2 weeks with the real patients. From the whole range, mm-hmm. all the way to the criminally, quote, insane ward. There was a gentleman, I was looking at his artwork, People on Fire. He was an arsonist, unfortunately, and yeah. caused some damage. And there was an orderly right outside the door. And in the movie, if you remember, there was a gentleman, he has his face, when he go to get electroshocked, he has his face up against the window. With permission, that was that gentleman. So we learned a lot about mental health, my father being a neurologist and brain surgeon, and my mother a nurse, and living in California with Reagan as governor. You know, he led all our he closed all the state hospitals and then became our first homeless. So the point to, for me about working in Cuckoo's Nest was the humanity that is in the story. That is the whole crux. And it was a wonderful, wonderful experience and changed my life.
Well, it changed your life in a positive, of course, way.
Oh, yes.
So you and I agree on that. But to be in an icon movie like that, how many people get, and that was your second movie. How many,
yes, it was.
You know, starting out, your intention was not to be an actor. You were just picked up off the street by one of the most incredible, and you're right. George Powell, it's a legend himself, and literally a legend walks in and say, hey, you know, how would you like to be into pictures? But from that point on, or at least after Cuckoo Nest, did you consider yourself typecast from that point on, considering the two previous roles that you played?
The answer, of course, is yes. And I'll be very honest with you. Every actor is typecast. If you're successful in whatever realm it is, if you're handsome, if you're pretty, if you're this or funny or that, you're going to be typecast. And it's just human nature, you know, what fits the role. And then as your performances become more mature and you have a wider emotional range to your art, then people will go, you can play against type. So when you can play against type, that is just a lot of fun. So if I do comedy or sci-fi, for instance, you can be a bad guy. Like, for instance, in MacGyver, when I'm sitting in the van and my lovely glorious ladies of wrestling, Spice Williams.
Spice Williams.
She's my girlfriend.
Yes.
And we're in the van, and I'm the bad guy, and we're doing all kinds of sinister things, and we're waiting for Jimmy Walker and some other people to do their work, and then we're going to take off. And she goes, you know, I go, well, you know, this Guyver thing. And she goes, no. When we're done with this mission, you never take me anywhere. So I'm the bad guy, and my girlfriend's, you know, giving me a hard time. And I go, well, we'll take a vacation. Really? Yes. Brazil? Really? Will you take me shopping? Sure. So you can play against type.
Yes, that's.
You can play against type.
Yeah. You're normal people. It's not like you're not normal, but it's good that they wrote that scene.
Well, sometimes even if they don't write a scene in a particular manner, the camera is rolling. So if any writers in the audience, you know, if you stay true to the arcs and the story, you can put in a little gem here. As a perfect example in Cuckoo's Nest, where a silent moment is huge. Toward the end of the movie, after the party and Billy's having his first date, Jack is sitting there next to the Chief, but the window is unlocked. You think they're going to escape. Of course they don't. And every night around midnight, a train would go by and you'd hear the whistle. And it was just sort of a lovely event. We only had a couple more hours to go, and then we'd go back to the hotel. So here we are, the camera's rolling, and Milos, the director, he did not yell cut. And Jack, here's what happened. Well, this won't take long, right, Chief? You know what I mean? He's kind of tired. And it's all reading on his face, all of this experience. You know, the nurse is being on his case, and he's gonna leave. He's gonna leave all of his patients there. And the train does its whistle, and Jack, train, Jack. And then, boom, it's morning and all, you know, all is discovered. So,
perfect.
Art, small can be huge.
That's perfect, absolutely. When you can read somebody's face and absolutely know what they're thinking or put them into that position of, you know, real life, let's say. That's what we like to see, movies, TV series, how we prefer they affect us, you know, give us something that we can remember by. All right, let's move on to The Hills Have Eyes. Raise your hand if you have seen The Hills Have Eyes, and it better not be anybody under the age of 8, 10, 30.
You know, how many of you saw it in a drive-in?
How many remember drive-ins? That's the perfect, that's a great date movie, isn't it?
Yeah!
At the drive-in.
She will want you to hug and protect her.
Anybody have any questions? I'll let you guys go. Anybody have any questions out here of The Hills That Have Eyes? If not, you could go ahead, sir.
After meeting Michael yesterday, I found it online and I started watching it last night, and I couldn't get through it.
Could you? Howard, what's wrong with you?
And I remember seeing it, you know, years ago, and it was on the 70.
Four, five, or six, something like that.
Yeah. And I could just breeze right through it, but now I just, it's like, holy moly.
Yeah.
The question I have for Michael is, is there a character that you'd love to play that you haven't had that opportunity yet?
Yes. Thank you, Michael. Absolutely. I've written some outlines for some stories. I'm writing my autobiography, and I am going to produce and or direct and star in some shorts. I have some people that do the short films. And one that I would always like to do, I always like the concept of the underappreciated artist kind of recluse kind of person. We all know people like that. We've all been in and out of that ourselves. And so I was thinking, because as a child, as a young man, I always thought, I didn't date a lot, have since, yes, thank you. I thought, what a cool role to have. It kind of reflects the role that I played in The X-Files. You know, the guardian angel protects the boy, gives his life, and it's so revealed. Well, I was thinking, you know, the kind of recluse artist lived in a cabin in the woods. You know, you can talk to the animals, all that kind of cool stuff. It's an old theme, been around for a while.
That's my life.
That's his life, right here. Lovely. That would
be a good ending to that story.
And then you can have the second line of the story.
Sorry about that. You might want to grab the kids, please.
Give them a beer.
Yeah.
No. Disclaimer. So I thought it would be cool to where maybe some people befriend them, the people in town go, well, he's a bit of an eccentric, you know, but, and then something happens and they need his expertise, and then of course maybe he meets the gal of his dreams or something like that. I thought it'd be kind of a sweet story. In my real world, I have been involved in real grit situations. One of my hobbies is to, if I'm somewhere and I see a woman in peril, I will ask some specific questions. And I'd also like to do a story along this realm. I have friends that have the northern continent, the United States, including Canada, they have a network of safe houses for mothers and children. One of my passions, the reason why will be explained in my book. Some names will be not put in there to protect certain people, and also to protect myself from some bad people. So, you make a phone call, and I say, are you in peril? Do you want to live? Okay. You do what they say, you write it down, it's none of my business, and you'll be fine. I believe art has a wonderful opportunity to tell stories and not only entertain, make us laugh, make us cry, make us wonder, make us ponder. Sometimes just, you know, clean the attic, pure fantasy. Well, you can also, in your writing, add the thread of humanity, because then it's a richer story. That's the difference between a video game it's the difference between scary horror movies and torture porn. Slasher movies, to me, that they have no redeeming value whatsoever. Maybe it's a learning curve and you'll appreciate something better later. So those are the realms of writing and storytelling that I will be pursuing.
You're absolutely right. I am not a fan of gore. Blood splashing everywhere, you know, necks getting sliced and things. It has its place. I'm a Walking Dead fan, so don't
I was going to say, but it's okay for some.
It's okay for some. Okay, but the classic movies back in the day where it was actually not illegal, but you know, inappropriate to show those type of things that are on TV, where it was fright, jumping out, the sheer look on the face of horror, scaring the living daylights out of you, the same as Hills That Have No Eyes and things of nature, you know, I consider that art.
It is.
You can throw blood up on the wall by throwing a can of paint and, you know, thinking that somebody's neck got slashed, but to literally go inside my psyche so that I can't sleep at night, you know.
Thank you, Wes Craven.
Good job. That's a part of this.
Yeah. I would love to what do they call it, doing a side to say a shout out to Gunnar Hansen and Wes Craven. Gunnar, by the way, has a script called Death House. All of his icons are still above ground. We're all going to do it. We're going to film it. So they're up there kind of smiling down on us today. Wes Craven, at his memorial at the Directors Guild back in February, was there, and his son Jonathan told us a story how his father met the president of the Audubon Society, and that gentleman came out and said the following. I first met Wes Craven when he lived in the Catskills, and he said, what do you do? He said, I go to bird watching. Would you like to come along? Wes Craven said, oh, sure, I'll go bird watching with you. So they went early in the morning, got to a beautiful spot, and the gentleman is pointing out this bird, that bird, this bird, that bird, and Wes goes, oh, let me look. Opera glasses. And Wes says, I can't see anything. The guy goes, please, here, try these Hasselblads. And Wes goes, I need a pair of these. You know. And Wes became an avid bird watcher. And then Jonathan showed, displayed pictures that his father had taken for years of wildlife. So somebody who can scare us as much as Wes did, it's an art form to make you feel disturbed. You know you've been effective as a storyteller when you're in the movie and you leave the hall light on when you're home. That was Hills Have Eyes for that. So well done, Wes.
When did you discover that that you've made it, let's say? You've already started out being in blockbusters, but in terms of being recognized, in terms of being generally appreciated for what you do, your art and things, what if there was a movie that brought you to that level, or if there was literally an experience in person, like at a 7-Eleven that brought you to that, is there anything in relation?
Yes, actually, my gratitude goes to Peter Locke and Wes Craven. We were having dinner one night, and he said, you know, when I was doing The Hills Have Eyes, I wear the leathers around over my shoulders. They were there because it was part of the wardrobe. They also served a function. I had major surgery under my arms and even had to go to L.A. to have some more follow-up carving done. And it lasted like 12 years off and on. Lots of fun. But I had a good doctor. My point is, they were there to cover my abdominal dressings that were stuck up under my arms. And it was a tough shoot. Hot in the daytime, cold at night. I don't do heat, so I was miserable in the daytime. At night, I was having a great time. Well, they told me that I never complained, and there was another actor that if we were 1 minute late getting back to the hotel, he'd call, within his rights, call SAG, and you'd get a bump. Well, if he gets a bump, the whole cast gets a bump. So it was kind of dinging them. I think our budget was $130,000 for the whole movie, something in that realm. And they said, so as a way of saying thank you, we're going to have you be our poster child. I go, really? Even more exposure? I mean, as a kid with a physical difference, I got in fights and I'd hate teasing and all that kind of stuff. And I go, great, more exposure. That's exactly what I need. Well, it helped. It actually helped. And I knew, that's what got it going, being on the poster of Hills Have Eyes. And one of my most proud moments is when I was watching Evil Dead. And in the cabin, there's a poster of The Hills Have Eyes. And that's why we had a Jaws poster in the motorhome.
Yeah,
it was the directors paying homage to one another.
Right.
And Evil Dead is a kick. I love that movie.
Oh, that's awesome! Yeah, so there you go.
Yeah,
that's when you were first. And we're talking 85? No.
Well, the original Hills was 76.
No, Evil Dead. Poster ended up on the wall.
Yeah, I'm not sure of the name.
Something like that.
Somewhere down the line.
Yeah. Okay. Excellent. Questions? Anyone have anything they want to ask Michael? Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. Your relationship with Wes Craven. I mean, I enjoyed your performance in his film, and he was such an amazing director. What was his approach to working with actors, and what was he like as a director in terms of relationships he built with actors or on set?
Wes was minimal. He put a lot of trust and faith into your interpretation of his instructions. And he, how can I put it? The roles really fit the individual actor. That was a big plus. He also had a very light hand. He had a childlike imagination. He was quick and witty. The only time I ever had a discussion with Wes and saying, no, I don't want to do it that way, was when he said, okay, here's a scene. You're looking at the family and you're talking to Papa Chu on the radio. He says, before you leave, I want to have some tension where you take your knife and you go, shh, 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 on a rock. And I go, no, Wes. Pluto's knife would be razor sharp at all moments. If you did that on a rock, it wouldn't play out. He kind of wanted that. I go, well, I could do like this. He goes, no, I did something quick, like shh, shh. And that was the only time I said, nah, I just don't think like that would, I was so into my character, I go, no, that wouldn't work. I said, if you wanted, I could like slice my finger. He goes, no, you can't do that. And then I worked with Wes and Hills 2, and then a little thing with the fifth, not the fifth floor, it was Nightmare on, it was not Elm Street, it was, I worked on the one in Texas with Ernest Borgnine. Deadly Blessings.
Deadly Blessings.
Yeah. That was nice, you know. And in the beginning, of course, you know, William Glantz is, knocking over the easel for the girl who's painting. And of course, he knows, the audience doesn't know, that there's some bad things going on. So Wes liked to do the slow reveal. Mm-hmm. You know, he gets you going in this direction. Oh, everything is all so and so and so and so and such. And then there's the twist. Like in The Hills Have Eyes, you know, the theme, of course, was in the right situation, your humanity will be dispersed into survival mode, and you will be as vicious as the Hills family. You know, when the son with the mustache, you know, just keeps stabbing Papa Jupe, it's like, Mars, it's like, please stop. You know, you're a white bread family. What are you doing? Yeah. So he always would throw the question out to. What makes you who you are, you know, our choices. So he was always pushing that envelope. Even in the film with the in Caribbean.
Serpent and Rainbow.
Serpent and Rainbow, which I really, really love.
Yeah. So, so obviously Wes Craven was a great director to you.
Yes.
But in terms of tough direction, I know you've already said you kind of bumped heads a little bit with Wes on how you think things should be portrayed.
Just that one time,
but yeah. Was there any movie and the director involved with the movie that you basically just wanted to twist their neck off there?
Well, yeah, you're almost spot on.
Hey, who?
Good segue there. When I did Deadly Blessings, everybody knows me, I'll just tell it like it is. I had a beautiful girlfriend in Texas who wrote me some fan letters, and we conversed, and I actually went out to see her like a month before we went to Waxahachie. She was a San Antonio girl, and she just didn't care much for the vixen on the set. She was beautiful, and she goes, I don't like these Hollywood people, they're pretentious, I want you to stay in Texas. Well, I didn't, and there was a situation where I think it was Maren Jansen, another actress, and Sharon Stone. We're all sitting in a tent, and it's cold. We're waiting to do the scene, and her name was Nancy. And I felt claws digging into my leg as one of those three actresses came up to me and goes, "Hi, Michael. Is this your girlfriend?" She said, not making any eye contact to my girlfriend, and she goes, "I can't open this drink. Will you open it for me, please?" And I feel these claws in my leg. This is going to be a wonderful two more weeks. So I go, what do I do? Yes, name, insert name. You have to snap it like you're wringing the neck of a chicken. And she goes, oh. And out she walked. And then there was a very tall electrician, you know, because they're stout, the guys, they got to move heavy things. And she goes, hi. So, you know, come on, they were young in their 20s, I don't fault them at all. And then there was this conversation. On a Friday night, we had weekends off, we flew back to San Antonio, and we're having a conversation, and she goes, you're gonna quit acting, you're gonna stay here, you're gonna marry me, and no more acting. And I'm not going back, and if you go back to the set, when I am under contract, of course I have to, I'm not going with you. And then it's all terrible. And she tore up every letter we ever wrote. I'm going, this is not good. And I don't know what to do. I didn't have a manual. I couldn't call Surrey. You know, old school. What are you gonna do, dude? And I didn't have a clue. So I go, give me a minute. So I it's, I have an hour and a half to catch my plane, to get to, so I'm be at work on a Monday morning, and it's 11 o'clock at night, so what do? I call Wes Craven, and here's how this conversation went. Michael, it's 11 o'clock, we have a 6 o'clock call. I go, yeah, I know, I'm at, where are you? Oh, I'm in San Antonio. You have to catch a plane. And I know, but I have a problem. What do you want me to do? He goes, well, such and such actresses and my girlfriend are not getting along, and I really need you to control them and have them stop behaving in certain manners. And he goes, there's a long pause, and he goes, Michael, I have no control over these women. Are you kidding me? And I go, oh, okay, I'll see you on set. And then I had to say, I have to go back to the hotel and get my bag and fly back to the set. That was the end of that relationship. My point is, fan letters are great, but sometimes they don't work out. Next question.
Wow. What you got? Anybody? Somebody had a question in the back?
I saw a hand back there.
Oh, I saw one too. Okay. Who was your most favorite co-star to work with?
Oh, wow.
Good question. It doesn't have to be just one. If there were people that you had great times with on the set.
Sure. I loved working with Ernest Borgnine. Mm-hmm. And Deadly Blessings. Great guy. And when I did, if I cry, it's okay, because I'm wearing my Crow shirt. I was a Skull Cowboy. I got to work with my dear friend, Brandon Lee.
Oh, right.
Safety on the set is a really big deal. Mm-hmm. If you have people from California that are armorers and experts, because you're in a right-to-work state and you don't like unions, and then the contract says now it's been so many weeks, now you can hire someone local who's not trained as well, something happens. They can miss something. That's why Brandon died. So he was absolutely wonderful. I would hang out in his motorhome, and I would tell him what it was like for me to grow up as a kid, my dad. He told me about his dad, his mom, and what it was like for him. He played the music, he was a musician. He told me about the songs he was writing and how he was engaged to be married. And I said, man, this is so cool, because we'll probably do a sequel, and I'm so happy your career's taken off, and I can be, I was the storyteller. I was the cadaver. I brought the crow in the way James O'Barr wrote the story. Unfortunately, all of our scenes left with Brandon. Whenever I'm in Seattle, I stop and visit is where he and his dad are. There's a beautiful, beautiful one. Rochelle Davis, who played Sarah Monster. We're very close. We keep in touch. We went to a screening in Sacramento at the Capitol Theater last year, where James